Daryl, thanks for joining us again. How are you doing today?
It's a great day. I'm so psyched to be back with you, Ben.
So we discussed a lot of stuff last time, but I'm really excited what we're going to be talking about today. And it's not something that I know much about. It's Trivium, which I think is like logic and rational thinking, I think. What is it?
Well, this is an ancient Latin term, trivium, from trivium, or three ways meeting. And it does nowadays refer to, in modern parlance, like I would say amongst many people on the internet, if you looked at Trivium Education, if you'd look on Tragedy and Hope, there's a whole Trivium Education tab for all types of methods. It refers to a semi-ancient methodology for critical thinking. And in many ways, it was a form of indoctrination for hundreds of years, but now it's, you know, been reverse engineered, I would say, to be applied to three different methods. That's where the three comes from, the try, to apply oneself to learn and study and teach any subject. And they are formed of the general grammar. That's just like, say, definition straight up. The, I would say, informal logic. And that's just making connections between these points of grammar and removing contradiction, or at least isolating and naming contradiction. That's what the logical fallacies are all about. And then moving from there to just classical applications of rhetoric, which is what that means is actual practical applications of your grammar mixed with your logic and then making it practical, called wisdom. Also known as, I would say, knowledge, understanding, and wisdom, grammar, logic, rhetoric, also known as input, processing, output, if you go into computer language.
Right.
Like that.
Wow. Okay.
Just like that.
Okay. So let's do some examples. So the first part, give us an example.
Well, okay. So the first part, we need a definitions of all things that we're talking about. So if you were talking about, as an example, people over there in England, and they all were, let's just say, you know, expressing a vociferous opinion on Brexit, on leaving, you know, for example, you know, the UK leaving the European Union. So now there needs to be definitions of what does that exactly mean by leaving? What exactly does it mean by staying? You know, you start to go into actually looking at actual definitions for what the terms are. Just the same thing as when you're like your terms of service or terms of contract. The same exact thing, Ben, for like if I'll go even a simpler example. Let's say you're talking about a little child who's learning for the first time to make a fire, learning how to actually put wood and paper together to make a long-lasting fire in, for example, a fireplace. So there's a way of doing this, but first the child is learning the grammar. This is paper. This is kindling. This is small sticks. This is, you know, basically bigger sticks. These are small cut logs. These are larger logs. This is the biggest log of all.
Right.
And
it's definitions.
Grammar. Yeah. The names are, you know, A equals A. This is very logical and rational. And children are, by the way, children are born with this method intact. They automatically are trying to affix names to things. They're trying to gain the grammar of the world. Kind of gather that you probably don't have a little child or didn't, you know?
Oh, not you. Oh, me. No, I'm not a parent.
Yeah. But even if you did, you know, like if you did, you'd see that the way they gain words in those first 2 years is phenomenal. Like I for my daughter, I was starting to write down the words that she could say, you know, because it was a very limited list at first. And then it grew so fast that you can't keep track of the words that she knows. You know, it goes really exponentially. So this is kind of what I would say is, I suspect it's built into all mammals, but for the most part, I can say for experience, built into humans for sure, that they are automatically hardwired. Like there's like a meta thinking or like a deep structure that's already designed to keep, like, to gain grammar. But the power of gaining grammar is very powerful in the beginning. So what happens is that this can get corrupted. So you see people who will be using a term that once would mean something and now means something else. Liberal once meant of or befitting the free. Would you like a liberal amount of gravy on your mashed potatoes? You know, it would mean a generous amount, a large amount, actually, or at least certainly plenty and enough. And now this term over here in the States could mean something completely different, something more of a proponent of tax and spend and all types of regulations, and actually kind of very restrictive, kind of the opposite of the original meaning. So in some cases, someone will be, you know, using a grammar term, and they'll be meaning it one way. And then at the same time, later on, like a few sentences or paragraphs later, they'll use the same term in a very different way. And, you know, it's unfortunate, Ben, I don't have like a ready example for this one. But I think that when you've had discussions with people, have you ever noticed that maybe the grammar, like the actual definition of a term, kind of shifted in the midst of the discussion, like mm-hmm. moving goalposts?
For sure. Yeah.
Do you have any examples that come to mind? Because this is one I didn't prepare for.
Example doesn't jump to mind, but I know what you mean. Sometimes people are very loose and sloppy with what they're saying and what they mean in, and they're kind of stretching the definition of things and kind of, and it kind of, when you're in a conversation like that, it kind of feels annoying because you can kind of feel how things are not well defined, and you know, and an example doesn't jump to mind, but I know what you mean.
Yeah, I think a lot of people listening, you got the idea. It's really important. This is why, you know, little children, again, they're very fixated on having one definition for one thing. And they'll get specific too, you know, not just share, but that specific chair. They're not, you know, like, and not just like kindling, but this specific bunch of kindling. So they get really precise on that. So when a child knows all these pieces of grammar, they, you know, like when it comes to them learning how to build a fire, just like I did when I was about 8 years old, I suddenly, you know, because that's when I had access to a real wood-burning stove at that time, there would be a logic to it. That's where it all moves to the next step. How do you put those pieces of grammar together to get to your outcome, your objective, you know? Okay. So that one is just basically putting the data into a formation. That's where you get the word information. Now it's in a format, you know, and you've removed some contradiction. So in the case of the child learning to build the fire, they learn that they can't just throw things in there. They can't just put a big log in and then pile some paper on it and expect that to burn. There's actually a logic to building a fire. And there's a logic to building a slow fire, like a smolder fire. There's a logic to building a very powerful and roaring fire that's going to make the most maximum amount of heat. And they learn that because there are, you know, three-dimensional contradictions to how things will work and how they sort of work and how they absolutely will not work. So they learn to say, oh, it starts with there's a logic to it. It starts with paper. It starts with the very smallest of kindling on top of the paper. It starts with understanding airflow. That's a movement of things, you know. It starts with building things up so that the heavy log doesn't crush the paper and kindling. That it comes down to, like, there needs to be more of a structure to support that heavy log. There needs to be all the things of in between heavy log and paper.
So are we in the second part of the trivium right now?
Yeah, we're in logic. This is the way of thinking logically. And right. It works that way in a discussion. Maybe you might have had discussions with people where they're obviously, you know, moving the goalposts. Now, they say that, for example, you know, the goalpost of gun control, for example. They'll say that all these countries that have gun control are peaceful places. And then you point out something where, wait a second, these are not peaceful places. People are actually being murdered more often there because they're not able to adequately defend themselves. Oh, well, I didn't mean those places. I mean these places. And then you investigate them, and they'll move to another place. And that would be, you know, moving goalposts is a logical fallacy. So there's the logical fallacies. There, you can Google 42 informal fallacies. You can look at all these examples, but it's basically, they're fallacies of what's relevant, fallacies of actual definition or equivocation, you know, one the definition meaning this and now it's meaning that. And there's fallacies of the neglected aspect to say, wait a minute, hold on, you missed this aspect of gun control. This is totally missing in the discussion. You know, the aspect of who owns what, you know, that's a very foundational component. I own myself, and therefore I own whatever I choose to want to own. And I could choose to to outsource someone else to defend me with weapons. I could choose to do it myself if I'm free, if we're valuing freedom of choice, right? So when you get bound down to a foundational discussion, you could see that there are people who would really wish to be right more than find out what is right. You know,
yes.
I think this is what I've noticed, is that the folks that I want to spend my unpaid time with, like you, Ben, is that I would prefer to spend my unpaid time with people who have a high value on finding out the ways that they are right in their conclusions and the ways that their conclusions are incorrect. Keeping in mind, beliefs and conclusions are the format of logic, meaning it's an attempt to make a theory of how the grammar works in the 3D world, or at least in a potential world somewhere.
Yes.
So I'm going a little bit more deeper on the idea rather than just naming and going through examples of fallacies. There are many of them, like the ad hominem fallacy. You've heard of that one, Ben?
That's where you insult people, isn't it?
Well, that's part of it. Actually, it's where you make the claim that because you're British, you could never understand the American system of governance. You know,
right.
So an example like the British in that case is being, could be implied as an insult to you. But in this instance, it's saying because of who you are, what you just said is irrelevant. You know,
yeah. Which... you hear this a lot, like because you're white, you could never understand the black experience. And so nothing you say matters. Or because you're a man, you could never understand the female experience. And so nothing you've got to say on the topic is valid.
Yeah, those are much juicier examples, man. I now I wish I had said it. but you're right. Because you're a man, because you're not in the transgender community, you could never understand. You know, you lack. Therefore, what you just said, your argument is invalid because of who you are, and that's an informal logical fallacy. Actually, that's not actually accurate. Or because these alleged 97% of these specific scientists said global warming is actually happening, well, then that means, you know, that they are trusted. But and because you're just a lone kook who, you know, doesn't really know things like scientists do, what you say could never counter those 97% of those scientists. You know,
What fallacy is that? Yeah. Is that appeal to authority or what?
The first one was an appeal to authority. The second one was an ad hominem. Because I'm a lone kook, what I say does not matter compared to those scientists.
Right.
See? So many people will just throw in a whole bunch of these. So here's a weird thing, because before we get to rhetoric, people will use these fallacies as their ways of interpreting the world and making actual theories of what's going on. They're going to use these fallacies to actually come up with their plan. And I think you've seen this with religious people of all kinds. I mean, right now, the religions are, you know, that of believing in certain specific groups of scientists is a form of religion. Believing in a certain in-group think, groupthink, for example, is a form of religion. Mm-hmm. If your whole group all believes in man-made global warming, then you feel very comfortable staying in that in-group, and therefore you'd feel uncomfortable leaving it by questioning it. You'd be feeling very comfortable staying in a Christian mindset where, you know, Ben, Jesus loves you, and that's basically all I have to say for this show. You know, that would be one thing, you know, like I'm staying true to my message, because people are going to be using the fallacies to stay right where they are. And the more firm they are with their conclusions, it's what I would call religious. Another one of those Latin terms,
so,
you know, to tie back.
So just know. To be clear, in the way that you're using the word religious here, you mean, what do you mean it to mean? What's the definition?
Firm, unyielding conclusions, religare, to bind up, to tie back, like the Latin for religious, you know, or one of the roots that could possibly be. I know people will be listening and be like, that's not the original root. This is the root, you know. And I'd say, okay, maybe, you know, because it's a very old word.
So it's like when
it's
you're
really about firm.
So you're so committed to the idea that you're unwilling to sort of be self-critical or examine, you know, any possible faults in it. Is that what it is?
Right. Exactly. Just like, see, the child who is, say, learning to build a fire was curious and the curiosity is there. So they don't have that firm commitment to belief. Instead, it's flexible, just like a child is more flexible than an old adult. And the same goes with the mind and thinking. So the child is ready to think and flex and see ways that they potentially could get it wrong. They're not jaded in thinking that they are, you know, committed. So the longer a person has been, I would say, committed to keeping a conclusion, their form of logic, the more committed they are, the harder it often is for them emotionally and mentally to consider that they got it very, very wrong, very erroneously, that they actually were using fallacies to create their conclusions, and that created small to major tragedies in their life and others.
Well, I can give you a great example of this. I was discussing this on a conversation the other day about nutrition and veganism. And I'm not an expert on nutrition. I've got nothing to say about what people should eat. But we were saying exactly this, that people become so committed to the lifestyle and the culture of veganism and treating it as a foregone conclusion that it is, you know, the best option, that it's like they're not even really open to considering any sort of dangers with it. And my friend was telling me about some examples of people, you know, that there's one guy died because he was so committed to being on a fruitarian diet that the amount of sugar he was eating, he got some kind of infection and the sugar, you know, made it worse and it killed him. And, you know, we were just discussing that kind of thing. And so, you know, veganism is just an example of like where you can become so committed religiously to it.
Exactly. You see, this is the thing. So, you know, like in the last session, in the last podcast I made with you there, we covered how to see people as people who, you know, are just semi-tragic in their ways that they make choices and express themselves. And this is the same opportunity here, because if you see people as the enemy simply because they are firm adherents to some conclusion or groupthink set of beliefs, their belief system, as they would love to call it, I'm sure. This is them, and that's the way they operate. And same thing for, like, to say, you know, Ben, you know what your problem is that you need to be vegan and you need to engage in Bikram yoga, like at least 5 sessions a week. That's going to really do your body right. Everything else is just going to encourage cancer and stuff. So, you know, like that, you know, and I'm sure you can imagine what, you know, the actual effects of taking that conclusion and putting it into reality would be, because you probably have tried some of that, you know.
So I'm thinking, so the stuff we were discussing last time, the nonviolent communication, so that's where we kind of have like a sympathy for, you know, where someone's at. But then with the trivium is more just identifying the actual fallacies themselves, sort of without
it gets any sympathy. More advanced than that, though. See, what I gave you last time was kind of like ways of balancing the internal emotional terrain for the purpose of staying balanced, not so much that you feel sympathy for them so that you are less in your own loop of I hate this guy, you know, and you got the anger. And you go back to thinking the things that enforce the hatred of the guy. And then you go back to feeling the hatred. And instead of being caught in that little loop, that's what I call a 2-quadrant man, you could go into being all 4 quadrants. And you'd be like, okay, so what's the anger coming from? What are the, you know, I know the thoughts. I got that. I identified those thoughts specifically, you know, totally advocating these destructive policies that are hurting them and other people. So then, okay, you got the anger. And then you move through the next part, where you identify what is it that you wanted, and you wanted rationality, and you wanted clear communication, and you wanted safety and security for yourself and others. And then you go and you figure a strategy that's going to get you all those things. Probably not with that person, but maybe with that person if you have to. You know, you could get creative. And see, this is also the trivium, where you're identifying components, and then you're finding what is your objective, that's the end point. And now you're identifying a theory using, you know, logic, removing contradictions. That's where you remove or identify logical fallacies, and you get to your goal in an effective and predictable way. See, that's the difference. Not so much that you have to feel really the empathy for all these people who make these poor choices that hurt themselves and others, but especially so that you feel the balance in your own way of thinking so that you don't get caught in a loop. You know what I mean?
Right. Do you know what? I'm kind of with you, and I'm kind of a little bit lost at the same time. So maybe you need to go a little slower with me. Yeah.
No, I can do it. I can do it. Okay, so because I'm mixing the two things. I'm mixing the method of nonviolent communication that I gave you last time with this new method, the trivia method of critical thinking right now.
Okay.
So that and I know, like, between this last week, you didn't go and listen to that three times and write it down and study it. You know, you got things to do.
Right.
You got real people to deal with. So, you know, it's like that. And yeah,
I got real feminists to argue with, though.
Yeah, your time is extremely valuable. You have feminists to argue with. You know? So,
let me ask you something. I think you saw one of my posts earlier. I was saying there's a clear contradiction. Sometimes people are willing to praise one group and only criticize another group, and then you know they're unwilling to praise one group and only will it, you know, vice versa. How do you explain that in the context of the trivium?
Yeah, in that context, I would see it as, so it's definitely, you know, that is definitely an interesting one. There's definitely a begging the question, that type of fallacy, where, like, you know, if you're willing to go ahead and apply this type of scrutiny to this group, that begs the question, What is it that stops you from applying that scrutiny to another group? And I'm not, like, pulling up the greatest number of fallacies right there. I know that some of it would be the, you know, genetic ad hominem of just making groups simplistic, which is in itself a problem because it's too simplified. You know, it's a lack of real defining of looking at people in groups in general is a problem instead of actually looking at actual individuals and real tangible actions. So, you know, often I look at that as just like an attempt at truly someone who's really trying to stay in their groupthink, and their groupthink allows for that type of heavy criticism of the other and minimal or completely eliminated criticism of their group, because their group provides them safety. And they're kind of caught in their own internal loop, you know, of the fear of they have this anger thought, these thoughts specifically that engage anger, these thoughts that engage fear, these thoughts that engage sadness. And they bounce back and forth between those two quadrants. They might even be suppressing the emotional part and just be like fully stuck in the one quadrant of the thoughts and not even paying attention to the feelings going on. They don't move beyond it to understand what motivates those feelings, to know then to take what effective strategy is going to get them to the outcome that they want. They're not even aware of the outcome they want, except for to hate the other and to be part of their group. So in that way, it actually succeeds. They hate the other and they love their group. They're right where they want it to be, you know?
Would I be right in saying their conclusions are informed from just their emotional needs as opposed to from critical thinking?
Mostly, yeah, because they're usually unaware of what motivates their emotional needs or the mention it, you know, when we this is important, and I know we're going to get back to the trivium in a moment, but the four quadrants, very importantly, you go through observations that includes all thoughts that you could identify as very, very relevant to the situation.
Wait a second. Nonviolent communication again?
This is nonviolent communication again. So I'm just pointing out that these people are stuck in a loop, and I'm showing you where.
Okay.
And then I'm moving beyond that to say this is what they're missing. You know?
Okay, yeah, go for it.
Okay, so they're stuck in thinking the same thoughts, and then some of them who are more tuned into what they're emotionally feeling can actually name and identify their core feelings. If they might have the courage to be honest, at least with themselves, anger, sadness, fear. Usually are the motivator ones. Usually joy is not in this specific example. And they're stuck. They go back and forth between those two, where they're stuck constantly reiterating just more and more thoughts to enforce the same conclusions and keep them right where they want to be. Mm-hmm. And the next quadrants past that are the motives the values and desires that actually create those specific feelings, because they are always evaluating the situation all the time. And you always have all this list of values. You know, this. I'll send you a list of values when I get a chance. But they are abstract qualities that the person has grown to really value heavily. And when they have less of these values, such as autonomy or freedom for people like us, or such as safety and security for folks who are afraid and want to impose limits on other people and their choices, you know, there's the people value I would say they put an emphasis on the values differently. That's the third quadrant. So you and I, Ben, now that we're aware of the third quadrant, we can identify what are those values that are at least deficient or under threat that inspire those thoughts and that inspire those emotions. And then we can go from there and to say, okay, so how am I going to fulfill a greater satisfaction with those values, avoiding all the rest of the stuff that's for the moment? What am I going to do as a tangible strategy and action to get there?
Right.
That's going all the way through.
I think I understand. Right? Let me repeat it back to you just to make sure I understand these four quadrants. So the first one is like unconscious reactions.
It's conscious.
It's conscious. The second one is being able to say what you feel, like a level of honesty about what you're specifically feeling.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
The third one is your set of values. Like I thought of an example. Like, for example, with socialism, people have a high value on like people being fed and not going hungry, and so they care about people, and so. Is that an example of where their values sort of then inform their conclusions about what should be done?
Yeah, almost. But they're abstract. They're not in the tangible. If we're going to split the two, okay, the feelings are abstract. You don't have like a sadometer. Not really. And these values are also abstract. So they might have a value for justice and equality and safety and security with food. You know, safety and security is in general. Food and, you know, like how food is delivered is a tangible. That's on the other side of a strategy, okay? But over here, they just want they want this sense of what is just and what is equal, and they want a sense of safety and security, and they will sacrifice other values for those too, for those, you know, several values right there. They will sacrifice autonomy and choice and volition in place of safety and security. And they might have learned basically to suppress the desire for those other qualities. So they're just basically qualities. They're like to say, what's the motive? What's the motive, Ben, for you to go into business like this? You know, and you'd have tangible things that you'd probably name because you're going right to the strategies. But underneath those tangible strategies of actually making certain amounts of money is safety and security. Also is the creativity. The joy of being creative, the connections that you make in your businesses. There's all these things that your business, businesses plural, actually do for you. And you could, you know, like many people, you'd be thinking in the tangible strategy and action area of this is what it delivers. These are the deliverables, you know. I get this package. I get these things. I get this awesome like place where you're recording right now. But underneath that is what you've learned to really truly value as abstract qualities, the motives that really make you either take action or avoid action.
Yeah.
And that's knowledge of self right there, you know? So that's the difference, you know, I'm speaking of.
Right. So knowledge of self is understanding the abstract things you're trying to achieve with the strategies.
Yeah. And so that first one, you went through that first quadrant. That's the observations. That's like your five senses coming in that you're always going to keep evaluating through the filter of what you value, of those abstract qualities. And that inspires you to have emotions, you know, unless you suppress them with some drugs or something. And that inspires more thoughts, more evaluations of everything that's going on. And all of that, you could get caught in a cycle of those three quadrants. But most people, once you become aware of that third quadrant, you tend to desire to move more effectively to the fourth one, which is taking effective actions that really get you to your objective. You know, and a lot of people, they're just kind of floating through without really tangible objectives in mind, except for the ones that are unconscious, like to stay in your groupthink and stay beloved to your group by not questioning them and only questioning the enemy group, you know?
Yes, right. Yes. Yeah, I'm with you.
So, bringing it back to the trivium for a moment, we've identified the grammar of nonviolent communication, of knowing the observations, knowing those feelings, and naming them simply of happiness, sadness, anger, and fear, and knowing at least a nice fat list of these abstract qualities that inspire both thoughts and feelings, and then keeping in mind all of that, finding the strategies to get to your objectives. Those are all grammar parts. And the logic of it means that, you know, you're actually putting this theory of nonviolent communication as I gave it to you, Ben, into practice. Show me now, like, show me. That's the final part of the trivium, is the wisdom or practical applications, aka rhetoric. In this case, rhetoric is my words teaching you and all the listeners, you out there, how to do this, how to think critically for yourself. When you know how to think critically, you identify your grammar, the definitions of terms. You identify if you or other people are giving you corrupted data in the form of informal logical fallacies. You know, and like I said before, you can put in 42 informal fallacies, 42 fallacies, and find a nice PDF on them. You can spend all kinds of examples of the informal logical fallacies that are out there and start learning some of them. But for the most part, you could identify that, you know, hey, this is a contradiction, or hey, this is perfectly in sync, meaning that this is in formation. This is the data that can be actually applied, like the child making an effective fire. And now, you know, we come to rhetoric or you know, classical rhetoric. Here's the three points of it. Think of it like a triangle, Ben. Mm-hmm. Right now, in terms of the spoken rhetoric, I am the author. And the words I'm giving to you and the audience, Ben, that's my message. And so you, Ben, and the audience listening, you're my intended audience. So it's a three-point triangle where I tailor my words as best I can to the audience. So it's my words, author, message, audience. It's like a triangle. And when my message doesn't land and you correct me on that, which I really appreciate, then I'm able to change the message, to go back, to try to slow it down a little bit, to try to add clarity here or add a piece of detail there so that you can see the thing. Because right now, Ben, it's like I'm in the Amazon trying to describe a car to people who have not even seen a road, much less a car. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Yeah.
And so I have to go slower than I would be if I was describing, you know, a really powerful Audi. You know, mm-hmm. I could go fast on the road. I could do that to you, Ben, because you've seen cars. But, you know, it's all me tailoring my message. The author tailors the message to the audience. And you'll notice, Ben, that some folks, they don't do tracking. They're not tracking you, Ben. So they'll be saying words to you, but they're not tracking your interest in the words. Or they're not tracking, you know, is this actually useful to you? Or they're not even tracking if it's useful to themselves. They're just sort of parroting back what they were given from other people. Hmm. They're missing the component of tracking the audience, so their message is lost on you and others. And you'll see that. And so the triangle, it's called the rhetorical triangle, is a powerful tool where you could always step back and for a moment say, okay, I'm the author now. How's this message being received to this audience? This, if it's one person, then you have them in 3D, like if we were on video, I'd be tracking your eyebrows and your facial expressions to say, I don't know if Ben's happy with this podcast this time around. Yeah. You know, like I better slow it. Okay, did I mess up? Let me try that again, Ben. Can you give me another chance, please? You know?
Right. So you can only track me from what you hear.
I can, yeah. I can track it like that, you know. But you'll also notice that you'll be dealing with people in your unpaid and your paid life who have minimal or no tracking skills. And that's a piece of data, a piece of grammar for you to take in. Oh, this person doesn't track very well. They're too in their own trip. So surrounding the triangle, the rhetorical triangle, is what's called the circle of context. That's what's going on around us. Like, I'm here in Hawaii, you're over there somewhere in England, and, you know, this is a day, this is a podcast. You know, you wanted critical thinking, I'm giving you critical thinking. Mm. And this is, you know, this is me delivering critical thinking. This is the context of the situation. You know, you brought up that Facebook post where you're making a query and seeing who's going to react to it. you know, like that kind of thing. This is all parts of the context that swirl around this discussion. And when you're really good at critical thinking, like what I try to be, but I'm not claiming that I totally am, you actually are not only keeping the rhetorical triangle in mind of author, message, audience, you're keeping the context of the situation in mind. You're keeping your objectives in mind, which is part of context. Like my context right now is to make an awesome podcast for you, man, you know, because this is your show, and to do my best to do that, to deliver it. How's that going so far?
Yes, I am doing my very best to follow the massive amount of information. A lot of this I'm hearing for the first time, so a lot of this is new to me. That I mean, you know, I'm familiar with bits of it, but not all of it.
Right.
There was a question that kind of that I thought of as an example. I had an experience where, okay, in terms of context. Sometimes it seems appropriate to kind of joke about things, make fun of things, mock, kind of make fun of people, you know. There's times where we accept that's okay and that's funny and no harm is meant, and then there's other times where people will kind of do the opposite. They'll be offended by, you know, like by something, as if it's the worst thing in the world, as if they never make a joke about anything. And I don't know. How do you explain that? What does the trivium have to say about that?
Well, here's what I would say about it, because the trivium is a tool.
Right.
And just like a computer or a gun, it sits inert and is used by individual users.
Right.
So what I would say is it's, again, the rhetorical triangle of understanding the message and the audience. So when you're the author and you throw out that piece of humor that you thought was going to, you know, land because it landed well for you, and it doesn't land well for them because they want solemn or they want some other type of seriousness. This is a, you know, feminism is a serious issue, Ben. We have no time to think of this as humorous. There are people hurting out there, and, you know, like right. That kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So I could just imagine that's tracking the audience. This is a moment where to say, you know, you can deliver the message like that, and you can definitely see how is it received by the audience. What's the reception? And you get to change and tailor your message based upon that, because it all does depend. What's your objective? You know, in other words, if your objective is shitposting on Facebook, then you don't have to care about closing a sale or, you know, basically making a new like client, making someone who's warm into your marketing funnel. That's not your thing, you know, because your thing right there is to say, you know, open up a can of worms, basically, and really like shove things right into people's face. And you get to see their reaction to that. And I'll tell you, there's three reactions I often see from people who don't have the skill set of balancing their emotions or balancing their thinking. They don't have the nonviolent communication skills internally applied, as I described them, and they don't have the critical thinking skills internally applied also. And here's what they do. They fight, they flight, and freeze. The three Fs. Mm-hmm. Okay? You will see this happen. That's why you'll see like a whole bunch of people not doing a thumbs up on that post that I saw. They flew away. They're not going to fight. They're not going to make an angry comment, because that takes energy, and they actually wanted to keep their conclusions intact. So I would say the, what's it called? Efficiency of their time and efficiency of everything, you know, is to just run away. And of course, if you're facing them directly, Ben, maybe you've seen freeze where like some, you'll say something and the person will say nothing, you know? Maybe you will also have seen flight where they'll change the subject, you know, probably in person though, there's very few people who have the boldness and courage to actually fight, but those are the common, I would say, usually unconscious reactions, because if someone engages in fight, flight, and freeze, they're not really very well in control. I mean, I've lost control even recently, you know, I've seen where I've lost my cool, and, you know, fought to bring it back because I took things personally instead of, you know, understanding where I was and what the stakes were. I saw it as an example of a time to look at the other person as the enemy and to basically, you know, declare a whole bunch of problems right there on the bat. I was not using these skills that I'm now giving everyone.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure you've done so.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, I'm following what you're saying. Yeah, makes sense.
I want to touch on where are you missing it? Because, you know, I know I'm giving you like the ways of balancing your mind with observations, knowing your feelings, knowing your values, which looks like I have to send you a list so you could get more clear on that, and then making a strategic set of actions that gets you to your objective. I think you've heard that enough. I think you can understand that having clear definitions, knowing that at least some rudimentary knowledge of informal logical fallacies and just like a virus scanner, making sure not to have them come out of you, making sure to identify them when they come at you, and then like being clear with your words towards your audience. I think you got that one, right?
Yes. Now that you gave it those like real world contexts, I've grasped it. Yeah. When right at the start of the conversation, when it was just labels, I was struggling to get it. But let me give you an example just to make so you can make sure I've got it. So the first part of the trivium, so it's the definition. So we're being clear about what things mean so that we're not getting our wires crossed about what we're talking about. So the second part is making sure there's no logical fallacies.
Yes.
There was something about stringing things together into a procedure or something. Was that part of the second part?
It's making a theory. So consider the first part, grammar, is also known as knowledge. So you're just taking in data. And so at what point are you done taking in data? Well, I'll give you the answer because I know that's a trick question. The part where you're about to take action. You don't have time to take in more data.
So for example,
with
my marketing, for example, I can track, you know, when people visit my website and, you know, it's got the cookies and the Facebook
pixel.
Got
a heat map, yeah.
And so, you know, so within the marketing system, there's data that's built up about who's visited the website. And then you're saying at the point that I'm ready to take action, like to target an advert, at, you know, that group of people or something. Is that a good way of visualizing it?
Yeah. So what you did is you're taking in the data, and then that's the grammar or the knowledge. Then the next part is you're putting the data into a format and you're making a theory. That's called a conclusion, or for some people, a belief. Like, I believe that now is the time to target this group with this advert.
Right.
You know,
right. So
that's your theory.
So now that I know these yoga people live in this region, then I know, you know, I've got a theory that if I target an advert at them, they'll buy tickets to my handstand class kind of thing.
Exactly. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Because they're ripe for it, you know, and you can infer that, at least you're pretending you can infer that because you've made a theory. And that's your logic. It's really putting things into format.
I see.
The informal logical fallacies are just a way of double checking that, so that in case, you know, you do a forensic and you say, what went wrong? Why did this not really get the numbers? You're going back and you're saying, you know, now it is time to collect more data. Now it is time to see what happened wrong. Your grammar work is never, ever totally done as long as, you know, you're interested in improving the situation. The problem with people who think they're done with grammar work is that they're religious, fervent believers, basically. they're done with grammar work.
Yeah, I see. They're done with refining the map kind of thing. I'm with you. So the stage two is we create the theory, and then the logical fallacies are sort of to verify or validate or to sort of to kind of root out any errors in the theory.
Yeah, such as the hasty generalization of all yoga people are going to love handstands,
mm-hmm.
you know, you know, I know that that's not yours, but I'm saying that's an example that you could have gone down that track. Like, all of them are going to love this. All of them need this. All of them are ready for this, you know?
Yes. Yes.
And that, of course, is a complete generalization, which, you know, in any, you know, generalization applied to actual humans is going to show signs of not holding up with evidence, because evidence is the knowledge and the grammar. And you're missing, you know, so you're trying to get accuracy because you have a tangible result that you want. That's what is the wisdom, the practical applications of your knowledge and understanding is wisdom. If it's practical, if you get predicted and desired results, If it's not practical, it's not wisdom in the way I'm defining wisdom. Okay.
Oh, yeah. Hang on. Wait a second. Yeah, I almost got that. Just say it to me again.
Yeah. So imagine that the practical applications of your knowledge, aka your grammar, and your understanding, aka your logic, is something that would be called wisdom if you get predictable and desirable results, meaning that, like, you use these metrics. The heat map showed these people spent this much time on the page. They're in this location. You targeted them, and it worked, and you had this many people sign up for your handstand class, just like you were predicting, just like you desired.
Right.
Now, so that's wisdom.
So wisdom's when reality conforms to your theory.
Yeah, and that shows that seemingly you did your grammar work adequately, though you're not done, and you did your logic work adequately, your understanding work adequately, though you're not done. You know, if you think you're done, well, you know, that's going to be hubris, and you could cause some problems down the line.
Right, because you know. Then that's back into the religious thing.
Yeah, that would be a problem. But it's the moment when you take action. That's the moment where many people wish to have a sense of confidence in their action. You know, otherwise they would be in a paralysis if they're not confident, right? So that's the moment where the grammar work ceases for a moment. That's the moment where the looking for more potential fallacies stops for a moment, because the action is about to happen. You know, if this was something like Brazilian jiu-jitsu and there were moves happening, then there would be things happening. Everything's flowing in fast play, and choices are being made in split seconds or pieces of a second. And, you know, after the fact, well, that's where you get to be academic about it. Now you can look at the video. Now you can see how I should have gone for this move. I should have gone for the triangle instead of, you know, trying to do that. That was wrong. You know, I see that, you know.
So,
but in the moment of it, you're taking action. You don't have time.
Right. So you have to commit to something at some point. Like, so you at the other end of the spectrum, you can be in paralysis analysis kind of thing, where you're so doubtful, so sort of self-critical of what, that you don't actually commit and act on anything.
Yeah. And keep in mind, there's a lot of unconscious story and training going on. These are like in the observation quadrant that we spoke of earlier. There's a lot of unconscious spoken stories that, you know, when you do the deeper work that I go into, usually individually when I teach this stuff, it's identifying messages that, like, and to put them out in the front, basically, messages that are said to oneself that were often said to oneself when one was a child. You know, as a way of regressing and going back to find them. And when you put those messages out front, you could suddenly find out that there's some pretty, I would say, counterproductive messages. And one of them would be that you need to be certain, young man. You need to raise your hand and have the teacher smile and nod and have everyone happy with you in class. And if you say the wrong thing, if you're not certain, you know, if you got the wrong answer, basically, not it's about you being right, not you about finding out what is right. Everyone laughs at you, and you learn to cringe from the ridicule. And that type of lesson can be in there for many people that you encounter. And you'll be, you know, folks, they're going to really want to be certain about their conclusions, and that's a problem.
Is that when you get like the smart ass know-it-all kind of person who's sort of overconfident about everything they know?
That's one example. And there's others too, where they just, they, you know, make sure to not even go to be your client because they're certain that they can't even do a handstand, that it's going to hurt them, that they're too, you know, they're too sick or injured or whatever. And that you're not really, you know, that you have nothing to offer them. They're certain about that because they are trained to, you know, have this compulsion. Some call an addiction to certainty. I don't like the term addiction, by the way, because I find it very limiting, especially in the terms of self-labeling, like addict. Choosing destructive and counterproductive behavior makes it understandable because now you could choose otherwise. Saying you're an addict is to label it as a permanent fixture.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah,
the
way we define our own identity is very powerful, isn't it? Because then that really there's a trickle down effect that then our actions and behaviors come from how we define ourselves, doesn't it?
Exactly. Man, I wish I was in a handstand class with you. So.
Right. So if someone, like if someone believes, I noticed this, like, all of the hobbies that I become involved with, like when I first started weightlifting, and I had a coach called Jada, and he was very into all this kind of psychology stuff, and he said some of the similar things that we've talked about, and he was saying, Ben, you know, you got to see yourself as a bodybuilder rather than just somebody that goes to the gym and lifts weights, which is like the behavior or the action level. You got to see yourself as a bodybuilder, like I am a bodybuilder, and when you see yourself as that on an identity level, then the actions will follow, because the actions will always kind of gravitate to how you define yourself.
Exactly. Yeah, I think you got the idea that it can be that thing. This is where I got a little rhyme for that. Labels, labeling is disabling, basically. You know, simplistic labeling is what you do when you're in a hurry. But simplistic labeling when you're not in a hurry, meaning it's all academic and open to scrutiny, like kind of like after you already did the marketing campaign. And everything hopefully is open to scrutiny because you want an accurate assessment of how it played out. In the midst of, you know, right before you choose to click and hit the button and push send, well, then that's like the same thing, like in combat sparring or something like that. That's where there's no time to really consider it because now you're committing to the choice. So, yeah, it's very important to understand, like when there is a simplistic message, like I'm a failure or I've got these health problems, I've got these limitations. Those are our messages. When you put the messages that are simplistic out in front, you have a chance to say, am I really a failure? You know, am I really that injured? Can't, you know, it's like, do I have the ability to really transcend these things and, you know, do handstand push-ups in 6 weeks, you know? So it's like that, you know, there's a way around that. So you'll encounter, Ben, the people who want to keep their same conclusions because it's very comfortable. In fact, I'm sure you've already encountered many of this examples of this.
What, where people are committed to their conclusions, or do you mean in the handstand
Yeah.
context?
Like in the terms of anyone that you've ever worked for, where they wanted to keep a limiting belief about themselves that you can see is there and is holding them back, and they very much would resist in any way, like taking, hearing anything that you say that is a contradiction of that belief. You
Oh, for
know,
sure. Yeah, I can
I
think of an
can't do it.
example. Yeah, for
Yeah.
sure. Yeah.
What's an example?
An example recently, I had a friend. He's very down. He's very depressed, and he only wanted to talk about everything that was wrong and da 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 on and on and on, and really resistant to talking about any solutions or anything to do about it to fix it. Just really resistant, you know. Just resist any. He only wanted to talk about what was, you know, how terrible it was, kind of thing.
Right, exactly. So you got the idea, basically. It's, you know, these are all tools, and the tools can be used to serve, you know, to get to the objective. And say on the flip side, Ben, you can actually use these tools to analyze how other people are choosing to make their path. Like in this case with your friend, he wants to stay in the same conclusions, and or at least seemingly for now, he'd like to say, step one is, I just want to completely reiterate and have you hear all of my list of my own grievances in my life, you know? And, you know, you might or might not find that, you know, doable. You have another example?
Well, yeah, with the handstand example as well, I do encounter people that say, oh, I could never do that. I'm too afraid to do that. I'm afraid of falling over and hurting myself. I'd never be able to do a handstand. Yeah, you know, I've had that.
Yep, like that. And the same thing for people who are afraid to learn how to swim, the same for folks who are afraid of learning how to drive a car. You know, there's all these many things that, you know, are dangerous, and danger inspires fear for a good reason, you know? That's what keeps you alive, you know? You know? Without that fear, you know, the fear is there to tell you, I'm gonna lose it. That's what fear's message is about, whatever the it is, you know. And that's, again, goes back to that map of the values and motives of a person, that the abstract qualities that they're tropic, you know, tropic towards, they go towards. So yeah, I do want to, like, let me name those emotional ones again, just one more time. Okay, Ben.
That's the quadrant, yeah.
Yeah. So if I go back into that emotional quadrant and I simplified it to four main emotions, keeping in mind that I understand that there's degrees of each of these emotions, you know, and I understand that there's complicated mixtures of them, like, but more importantly, it's happiness, which means I've got it. So like in this instance, I'm happy. I feel that I feel the joy because I've got this connection. I got, you know, the quality of connecting, of clear communicating with you, Ben. The, you know, because I've been looking at your stuff for years on Facebook, and like, you know, it took me this long to get through to you and to get on your cast, you know.
Oh, I'm very pleased and, like, you did.
Yeah, and to just show that I have value for you, you know, like I feel the appreciation for my skill set. I got these qualities. I got the joy because I've got it. The same thing for fear. I'm gonna lose it. Like, will I ever get back on the show again? And that's not my fear, but you know, like, I mean, more real fears, like, you know, like the lava eruption starting up again, real earthquakes that could hit me here. They're not a pressing fear right now, but recently, in the recent past, those were real fears. You know, really was rocked by a pretty big earthquake near, you know, right here, and really got to experience living 8 miles north of a lava flow. You know, I got to see that. I got to experience it. I got to see it affect many people. Mm. And that's the, I'm going to lose the safety, security. I'm going to lose the connections when people move off island because they can't take it here anymore. You know, that kind of thing. There's sadness where I lost it. Like, I had the client, and for whatever reasons, I lost it. They just didn't want to work with me, Ben. You know, I lost the safety and security provided by that income. I lost that type of connection. I was wanting to learn who this person was and how I could serve them and the mutual relationship that can develop. And then, of course, there's the anger of I want it, you know. I want to beat this critical thinking method and this emotional balancing skill set into people's heads. God damn it. Oh, man. But they just don't get it, Ben. They don't sit and listen to me. And then when I tell them, Ben, they just go ahead and forget it. You know, these people are so fucking I want the safety and security that I would get in this world if everyone was to adopt these skill sets. That's a conclusion. I could be wrong on that. But I think that I would have greater satisfaction in my connections with people were everyone using this or at least adequately similar methods to balance their way of thinking and the way they deal with their feelings. Got me? You know, I think that I would get greater connection. I would get greater prosperity too, because people would just be less emotionally volatile. And then I would have that prosperity. There's all these things because I want it, you know?
Yes.
So those are the things like that. Happiness, I've got it. Anger, I want it. Fear, I'm going to lose it. And sadness, I lost it, you know?
Right. Yes, yes. That made sense. I was just trying to picture how those things fitted into the four quadrants, because I heard you talk about the emotions you experienced and then the values that you thought important, that you thought would be fulfilled or lost by them. But where are those in the four quadrants?
Well, the feelings is in that second quadrant, right after you identify all the five senses plus your thoughts, the relevant thoughts, you know, things that you could write down, basically. You could identify if you're able to feel feelings. Some people shut that down, but if you haven't shut it down, you can actually identify, I'm feeling, yeah, you know, I'm honestly feeling a little sad right now. Okay, so that's an I lost it. What's the it? And that, those feelings help to identify what's the connection to the thoughts and the five senses, and what's the connection to those values and desires, those abstract qualities that create a motive to evaluate your situation.
I see.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's just a connecting point right there. Think of the feelings like your skin sensations for heat and pressure. Like, the feelings are very important. They alert you to what you're touching. They alert you to make sure you don't burn yourself. Mm. Or freeze yourself, you know. It's really important. So for people who take these types of drugs that would numb that, there's the danger because it turns off all the feelings, and it would be like trying to turn off your skin sensations. So, it would be dangerous.
So that sense data is in the first quadrant?
The five senses are the first quadrant of your actual five senses, plus any relevant thoughts that you like you think is relevant enough to the situation. You get to be the arbiter of that. You get to evaluate to say, that's a relevant thought right there. And you can either say it to yourself in your head or write it down or just somehow, like, you know, highlight it, somehow identify it as a very relevant thought. That guy's an asshole. That's a relevant thought. If it comes up, that's a pretty strong thought. I would write it down or, like, you know, like, note that, you know, right there. And because, you know, basically the five senses, I saw him cut me off in traffic, you know, I want. And then you want the safety and security. You want the ease and efficiency of driving with minimal tension, you know, ease and efficiency. You want ease and efficiency. You want safety and security. And then, you know, if you're going to be four quadrant about it, you're going to make a strategy and action that gets you where you want to go. You know, that's defensive the fourth driving. Thing. Yeah, that's the fourth quadrant. Yeah. So you'll see people, Ben, the people who are very emotionless, whether they've stuffed it down with drugs or they just are, you know, the academics who stay very much in their head. I don't really have any, you know, the feelings or really, I just, you know, they might express maybe one feeling, like a minimal amount of happiness. And it's occasionally okay for them to express some anger. Those, you know, that group over there that I don't like, it's the men. You know, I'm angry at them, you know, like that. Or, you know, maybe a more emotionalist kind of group, the academics. And they would be stuck like there in one quadrant. Then there's the groups who are very emotional. So they bounce back and forth between the two quadrants. These could be some feminists you might speak with, you know, or type to or whatever. They are bouncing back between their thoughts and their feelings. And their thoughts inspire more feelings. They're not in any way paying attention to the values and desires that motivate those thoughts and motivate those feelings. They're just bouncing back and forth, back and forth. They're out of control like that. And that's how they've learned to do it, because they emulate behavior that they was taught to them. They didn't learn. They apparently didn't take my course, Ben.
So there's I kind of got several questions in my mind. There's several things that came to my mind. So yeah, I think that's very interesting when you say about some people are kind of less like emotional or less aware of their emotions I don't know what to say about that, but it's kind of fascinating, isn't it? Because I think I'm quite a sensitive person. I'm quite self-aware of my feelings, and I'm able to articulate and say how I feel with, you know, with quite a lot of detail. But yeah, not everybody does, do they?
No. I mean, some people have made it a habit to really turn that one down. If you're in a warfare situation, you don't have the luxury of that, of actually feeling some of those emotions. You might have no luxury at all to feel any of them at all. You ever watch any spy movies, you know, these assassins are doing stuff? They're pretty plain, straight up emotionless. The stuff that they do is gruesome. Their life is gruesome. You know, everything is like really gruesome, like in reality, you know. I mean, they might be using gadgets and they might be like doing thrilling, daring things, but the thrilling, daring things that they do, they can't afford to even feel the fear, you know. And when people get shot, they can't afford to feel the sadness, you know, because they're in a warfare type situation. Some people, you know, in inner city squalor of certain types where there's lots of warfare of a different sort, they don't have the luxury of feeling things. You and I probably don't interface with people who don't, you know, fit like this, because they're dangerous, generally speaking. Many of them are, of course, you know, labeled as criminals because they engage in things that are highly destructive, in win-lose situations, as I would call it.
Right. So are we saying if somebody was brought up in a kind of hostile environment, stressful environment, traumatic environment, they're more likely to be in a war mode, that, you know, where like you said, sort of nuanced emotions are, there's no space or time for that. They're a luxury and a distraction.
Right. And that's just one example. But there's the upper class example of that too, Ben. And that is, in high levels of academia, to gain that PhD, the trauma, I mean, there's this book called Disciplined Minds by Jeff Schmidt that I highly recommend. There's an audio book. I could send you a link later on for it. But certainly the written work is very worthy. It's to describe the soul-crushing environment of these high-level endeavors of gaining these credentials. And literally what happens to these people is that it is like a form of boot camp and warfare that they go through that is really trying to crush the emotions out of them. Even to go to get one's MD or medical degree here in the States, as it's called, it can be so traumatic. The sleep deprivation, the situations that they're put through, it creates a person who has limited the amount of actual feelings that they're accessible to them for the ones who successfully get through to the credential. And successfully take that credential and make, I would say, a financially vibrant career out of it. They might make that vibrant career out of it, but at great price, you know, because that price might be actually literally scrunching down the actual, I don't feel anything, you know, like they just literally don't have to feel a damn thing.
I'm also imagining like an Olympic athlete or an elite athlete that's that has to train so hard is basically the same situation. They're kind of it's like they've got no personality. They're just this machine really that just trains, and they're just so finely tuned that like everything else is they've shed away every the other aspects of sort of being human kind of thing.
Many of those Olympic and professional athletes deal with a lot of pain. One of my colleagues in the field of acupuncture used to professionally only work for Olympiads, those in the triathlon especially. And he got to see people who, you know, would fracture, you know, parts of their leg, you know, the lower bones in the leg, the shin bones essentially. Mm-hmm. And he'd basically be telling them, look, this will heal up properly. You know, I just gave it a treatment. You have medicine, you have treatment, everything's going good, but it will heal properly if you stay off of this leg for minimum 2 months. And then the next week he sees them off in a race running on it. Mm-hmm. So what that means is that they are literally, you know, conditioning their own system with pain, you know?
Yeah.
And that is a very dangerous place, just like, you know, MK Ultra, which is another pain conditioning thing, a different mind control kind of a subject. That was MK Ultra was a very verified program in the United States covert intelligence operations to try to condition people through very traumatic experiences to split their personalities apart. So this is a thing that people would engage in the other things I was describing, and like, say, endeavors that are traumatic, whether it be high-level PhD or inner-city gang warfare or, you know, actual, like, military combat. You know, it wouldn't really matter, you know, the setting. What would matter would be, does the person have an awareness of this stuff? If they push the feelings down, if they're a one-quadrant person, Ben, then it is very dangerous for people around them because they're in, like, a little bit of an echo chamber, you know, and they might be very prone to make win-lose choices rather than win-win choices like what we're doing, where we're engaging in making this discussion. And I'm trying not to completely over, though, you know, you give me great latitude, to make a great and entertaining podcast. I've been told that it's way too dense. Trust me, this is like the, you know, probably like the 150th time I've done this kind of a podcast. Okay. So like, I know what it means. Like, entertainers make more than educators, and I want to make this more entertaining because I want to boost your own, you know, your bottom line too. So it does come down to that. I want to make a win-win situation, and people who are damaged in the ways that I described, they might be very well prone to making win-lose decisions, to think that they can only win if you and other people lose. Have you any experience of people like that?
I really avoid, and I don't allow, I'm quite selective and picky about not allowing people like that into my life, which I think is a good thing, I think. I mean, what do you call it? Is that like, is that what a psychopath is?
You know, that's the simplistic label, but really it's just about a traumatic conditioning that produces the, you know, individually unique behavior set that the person, you know, has chosen, because they're basically choosing usually what was taught to them. See, like the method of critical thinking that I just gave you today and the method of emotional balancing that I gave you last time and today, they are new tools that I applied to myself to change from a similarly traumatized childhood, you know, not as bad as, you know, like full combat and stuff, but still, you know, like for me going into compulsory public school, as it's called, or government school in reality, was very traumatic for me because it was not a conducive place for the environment for someone like myself. You know, it was slower than I would want to move, and it was filled with repetition and tedium that had no practical application. It was a horrible and traumatic experience over time, kind of like, you know, like a really, really slow form of torture, basically. I applied myself to these skill sets to change the way I think. My theory is that anyone who is so-called labeled a psychopath could potentially retrain themselves with these skill sets. They could potentially choose otherwise. They always have choice, right? So to label them simplistically as psychopath or sociopath and say that there's no hope for them is one way to go about it, for sure. And also you could say it's too expensive to show them these options. That's also true. And I try to avoid these people when I identify them as well because they are dangerous and expensive. But in general, Ben, I try to like look at it this way. It, you know, simplistic labels are really for the purpose of danger. Like, watch out for that person. They're dangerous. You know, is I may as well say that instead of watch out for that person. They're dangerous. Some would call them a psychopath, you know. And here's why. And like, I mean, it's like quick labels just for the purpose of identifying a danger and a threat. But once we have time and it's academic and we're, you know, having tea and hanging out, well, now we could go more nuanced as far as the labeling part goes. Mm. You know what I mean?
Hey, tell us about what you do. I mean, you teach, and how do you apply this stuff in the world? Like, why is this important to you, and how long have you been applying it?
Well, you know, I mean, last time I said it was like teaching this 8 years, and I was like, oh man, I said that wrong. It's really a lot more like 6 years, you know.
Okay.
But yeah, so that's a little addendum. One on one, especially when I worked as a professor in the acupuncture college over here, the Big Island of Hawaii, I did get to do some lessons of this in class because it applies to how to help these students deal with clients. The clients who are in the student clinic and the clients that they'll be facing in the real world on their own with no one there to help them, generally speaking. And they are methods like that. I would be teaching them mostly, especially one-on-one. I keep applying myself to, you know, I have a constant student that I work with every twice a week, basically. And periodically I have people take me up on learning these skill sets because they hear how I deliver them and that they want that. Right. So it's mostly that stuff is one-on-one. And my passion, of course, is coming from it serves me practically to use this. Like the more I use the skill sets that I'm giving to you, Ben, the better my life actually is. And the more that I put these skill sets aside and make someone else the enemy in my mind or to engage in some pretty harsh affirmations that are against myself. Such as my, you know, like where I'm not successful with a business that I want to be successful, for example, and like I start to call myself names for that. That's a moment where I'm losing, you know, using the skill set. So I see where it works for me, and I see when I drop the skill sets how it negatively impacts me. Hmm. And my passion is to think that, you know, look at it this way, Ben. Everyone out there who's an adult right now has an operating system that was mostly corrupted because most people were actually forced to be in situations of government school or compulsory schooling and were forced into situations of tedium where they were not given practical applications of why they had to memorize and spit back these things onto tests, where they were basically punished for creative thinking and where they were rewarded for obedience and conformity. And they actually are rewarded for this type of philosophical apathy, you know, like in other words, like engaging in the thinking the same way. Like, Ben, if you just called yourself a feminist and you just did go ahead and engage in a vegan diet and, think of the women you could get with right now, right, Ben? You know? Yeah. You know? Yeah, so I'm just telling you, here's the practical application of that. That would be going against where, but instead, you have chosen a different path of valuing, you know, to understand cause and effect more, a rational and logical approach to things. You wanted a solid basis of things. So you're not going to do that, basically. You know, instead, you value what would be more applicable to, you know, rationality and logic. And that gets you the results that you get, you know. So, you know, I'm giving you examples basically of, you know, why I do this is because I see that people have had their operating system corrupted, that what I'm offering is an update, a firewall, you know, a virus scanner, a whole system of things. And they only work when you use them, though. They actually take effort to use them. I have taught this to people and I've seen them start to use it and drop it. Because I see again that they, you know, in the deeper level of thinking, Ben, they like their group. They like their group think. Their group protects them. They can't imagine leaving their little group. Their group doesn't question certain things. What I'm saying questions these things. You know what I'm saying?
Yes. This brings up even more questions. Hey, by the way, how are you for time? Are you okay to carry on talking?
I'm good to carry on.
Okay, yeah, a few things have come up in my mind. The topic of IQ, is that something you know much about? I mean, I'm wondering, you know, you strike me as very intelligent, and I'm wondering, I mean, is IQ, you know, what can you say about IQ? What am I asking? I don't know.
You know, that's a good question, because, you know, like, okay, like a lot of people, I take mentors. You know, like I have a mentor. I choose my mentors younger than me, if possible, because I like the stability and humility, and I like the curiosity, and they've got it. Usually the older mentors I've chosen are too rigid, and they're not flexible enough, and they certainly lack humility, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. So my mentor actually went through an extensive IQ series of tests that took more than 6 months. I think it was close to 8 months. It's a lot of testing to measure all these types of ways of thinking, of what is, you know, elements that are what are called intelligence. And it came up, you know, pretty damn high in the, like, a 160s kind of range like that for him. And having spoken with him at length for 3 years now, he's been my solid mentor for 3 years. I would say that he's kind of above me. I think what you might see is that I have an intelligence with speaking and communicating that I've developed using the skills that I just showed you in this podcast and the one previous to this. Okay. So I have a specific subset of intelligence. However, like looking at my bank account, you could say that is not financial intelligence, Daryl. Okay. That's not it, you know. And I'm not complaining and I'm not like belly aching about it. I'm just saying I didn't do it yet. But I'm gonna, because I'm applying myself in that direction. If, you know, same thing. And like there's realms where I would say other people have greater intelligence than me, and I study them as best I can from the vantage point that I'm able to. So there's many types of intelligence. I'm engaged in this type of emotional work, group work that I do every week that gets deep into emotional intelligence, deeper than what we've touched upon, Ben. And to some degree, I've gotten good at that, but I see people who've got more in that direction than I do, okay? So it's always like I identify what are the levels, like based upon achievement, and then looking at also the strategies of how they achieve it and how predictable they achieve it. You know, how you know, they have a desirable result, but how much do they get that predictable as far as results?
Right, like, and, is it repeatable?
Yeah, I mean, I personally have never been measured with an IQ test, so I don't really know. I think that the whole thing is very simplistic. It's like labeling again. It's a little too simplistic for me, but I do understand that if you want to call me intelligent, fine. You know, I would say, just like John Taylor Gatto, one of his famous quotes, genius is as common as dirt. John Taylor Gatto is a very famous American educational reformer and multiple-time award-winning teacher before he left all of doing that because he didn't want to hurt children anymore. Because he saw, basically, that the only way to help the students that he had was to break the law and get them out into the real world to actually do practical things.
Right, right.
So are you familiar with John Taylor Gatto?
No, I'm not.
Yeah, so highly recommend The Underground History of American Education is a big tome, but just the simple short one. If you just were to Google John Taylor Gatto, the 7-lesson school teacher, that would be these horrible lessons that include these main ones of obedience, conformity, and philosophical apathy. those are powerful things. So what I've done, Ben, is that I've undone some of the damage to myself. I would say that were I not, I'd say chemically damaged with certain treatments as a younger child, and then, other further damaged by having to go through those forced schooling experiences, all kinds of things like that, I probably would come off even more intelligent.
Right. You know? It's interesting. I've noticed some people think intelligence is a myth. It's like they reject the concepts at all, which I find ridiculous. There's something just hilarious. There's something ironic about that I find hilarious. Like dumb people don't believe intelligence exists. You know, I mean, I don't know what to say about that.
I would just say it comes down to grammar and definition again. Like when I say intelligence, I mean some degree of a provable track record of using the knowledge and understanding to get predictable and desirable results in a practical way. Mm. That's intelligence to me. And so no matter what the objective is. So for me, my objective was clear communication with you. So far, I think I'm doing good. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm clearly communicating to you. But if you went, if you Googled me and you found the first YouTube video that I did with Richard Grove, on Tragedy and Hope, it's called Merging the Trivium with NVC, and just put that into your YouTube search, you'd see that I don't communicate nearly as clearly in that one. That's 2012. I can't watch it. I shudder to watch it. Actually, so it's everything is a work in progress.
That was one of the other things I was going to ask you. Have you got online content? Because it'd be great if you got online courses that people could go and look in detail at, the things we've been talking about.
I put that whole thing aside because I was finding that my original attempts to sell, people don't want to know that they don't have critical thinking was one of my obstacles. And they don't want to know that they have emotional balancing habits, I would say, that are self-destructive. So I found a recipe for how to sell that and how to deliver it, but I put that on ice because I saw that the viable thing to go economically speaking was to work really hard to make content safe as a business happen, and to really focus my mind as a marketer and copywriter, and to go like that, and also to treat people holistically with health. And then to privately on the side to do that. But I will be opening that up. Now, I did have a portfolio site of all my productions, which is just – it's down for maintenance right now. But it's voluntaryvisions.com. Okay. And that was the portfolio of my work. I wish that it was up because I could point to it and it has some 150 hours of podcasts like what you hear me doing right now.
Oh, wow. of your own content.
Yeah, mostly I'm a professional pod guest. I show up on these podcasts and I deliver messages too similar to this, but sometimes, I've gone into a lot of different topics because all this stuff can be applied to anything. I've applied it to artificial intelligence and movie reviews. I've applied it to current events, such as when Trump was elected, there was a lot of emotions going on over here. Can you imagine?
I was aware of that. Yeah.
Yeah. So things like that, there was all these things to apply these skill sets to. And right now, I'd point to some of my best appearances. I liked how I showed up on Liberty Under Attack podcast. These are things that would go into a search engine. I like how I showed up on the Liberty Forge. I'm going there again soon. The Liberty Forge podcast. And I certainly I stand behind everything I've done on the SchoolSucksProject.com School Sucks podcast. Okay. And you could find, those everything on that one. I stand behind that type of production. But there's a lot of productions that I've done that I would say, oh, man, I can't listen to this. But I know at the same time, here's the weird thing, Ben. People say they get value out of it anyway.
I mean, I really enjoy listening to you explain stuff. So, I hope you can put yourself out there as much as possible. I think you're very talented. You're very talented at explaining things.
Oh, you're getting me to blush over here. Thank you.
Yeah, it's great. I mean,
that's what I was thinking about you, man. Because I've been like literally, I've been following you for years. You know, just seeing what you can do. Where didn't you start off with guitar lessons?
I did.
Or
That's true. Yeah.
yeah. But what did you do? How did you make that successful?
Well, originally I was just a regular guitarist playing in bands and teaching guitar lessons. And then somewhere along the line, I started learning about internet marketing and came up with the idea of making it into an online guitar lesson downloadable video kind of thing. And that was okay for a couple of years. It was really successful. It made good money for a few years. And then I made some bad financial choices, got myself in a financial mess, and ended up with a tax bill that I didn't have the money to pay, through no fault, nobody's fault except my own, and went bankrupt. And then I was sort of a little bit lost and a bit drifting for a few years, and I spent a lot of time watching conspiracy theories and sovereign citizen and tax protester, kind of, anti-government kind of stuff, and just a lot of time just watching videos about that kind of thing, which I don't know, some useful. I learned some useful things about the way the law and the courts work, but ultimately it was a bit of a waste of time. And then I got bored with that and started trying to have more fun, and that's the point where I started learning to handstand, and also my hair fell out as well, which made me self-conscious about how I looked, which is what made me start exercising and getting myself in shape. And then I spent about 5 years doing handstands and fitness and gymnastics and stuff, and then that brings us to this point where we are now, which is where I've got fed up with that, and I'm more eager to make more money and do more business stuff now. So that's where we are now.
Ah, oh, nice. You see, I only know the rosy first part where you jumped in on the internet just at the right time to really market your guitar teaching at the right way and really open that one up. And that was brilliant. And so yeah, like all I knew was the success part of
All right.
But I did know that you studied all the other subjects. I knew that you studied, and I've gone down some of those rabbit holes myself, because it's fascinating. And I think we have this in common, that curiosity where we're not afraid to be curious and study the potentials of what's going on around us. And that's the story I tell myself. So, I would say I'm looking forward to working more, off the mic with you as best I can to like get that success up, because this sounds perfect. This is exactly what I want to work for, and I look forward to it.
That's great. I'm sure. Yeah, I hope we can we both apply our talents and our skills and sort of make more money for ourselves by the sound of it. It sounds like we're in the same place with that.
Exactly. Yeah. And yeah, I'm at that point where, you hear the message I have. I only put it in the freezer. I didn't like take it behind the barn and shoot it in the face. I'm gonna take these skills. I'm gonna unwrap them. I'm going to package them up in the way that would be accessible and desirable to people. And to do that, as I've learned in marketing, I have to directly target to specific people's pain, So, that's the only way it works in marketing, is like I have to go for people's pain. And some of the pain is going to be hunger, and some of the pain is going to be fear, and that's marketing.
True. Yeah, I think that's correct. Yeah, that sounds like a good plan. I mean, I'd offer to help, but I don't think you need any help. So, but
Oh.
if there's anything I can do for you, I'd be happy
Oh,
to.
you got it. I think I'll just be like, how about this? Consulting offline, so you, the listeners out there, now you get to know that this is the point where me and Ben started actually, scheming behind the scenes.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Well, I think you've been very generous with me, to me, and to our listeners as well. So I really appreciate you taking the time. There's a lot of brain power there. There's a lot of knowledge. I mean, it's taken you years and, thousands of hours of study to accumulate these understandings. And so I don't take that lightly. I appreciate you explaining this stuff to us.
I'm really grateful to have the venue for it, Ben. This has been really brilliant. Thank
All
you.
right. Okay, I'll leave you to it. Thanks, Daryl. Thank you again.
Thanks, Ben.
All right. Bye-bye.